Good afternoon. It's a wonderful meeting and a great time to be in genetics. I'm really pleased and proud to introduce the winner of the inaugural ASHG Early Career Award, Daniel MacArthur. When I hired Daniel to start his first independent laboratory 5 years ago, I knew he had the potential to be a star of the future in human genetics, but just how quickly and brilliantly his star would ascend, I could not have envisioned. Daniel's most visible achievement has been the development of the Exome Aggregation Consortium, the world's largest compendium of protein coding variation. This resource, accessed roughly 10 million times by more than 400,000 users, has transformed human genetics, both in clinical settings where it has become the linchpin of processes to distinguish benign from pathogenic variation, as well as in research, where it has provided equally transformative insights into natural selection, mutational penetrance, and common disease. Of course, the driving reason behind that effort is Daniel's deep commitment to Mendelian disease genetics. He has led dozens of papers on rare disease gene finding, both generally in terms of developing robust strategies, rigorous standards, and computational tools, and specifically in muscle disease research. Of particular note, his achievements were recognized when he successfully, as PI along with Heidi Rem, competed to become one of the NHGRI's Centers for Mendelian Genetics, by receiving, I might add, the only perfect score on a grant I've ever seen. And in his own lab, he has led particularly compelling and innovative research on the use of RNA sequencing data to diagnose a number of Mendelian patients for whom DNA testing alone was inconclusive. Finally, even before publication in Nature, the landmark EXACT paper, which is an instant citation classic, was downloaded more than 18,000 times in preprint form from the bioarchive, underscoring Daniel's fervent commitment to free and open access to all of the products of research. His consistent and tireless advocacy on behalf of open data sharing, the importance of free access to the results and reports from all of our research activities, and his commitment to bring rare disease genetic diagnostics directly to families are amongst the things that I admire most about Daniel and in which he has helped influence my own thinking and actions in recent years. It is without question a shared responsibility that we consider the patients and families that we are serving first when we consider policy recommendations and actions in these areas. It's really impossible to verbally capture the impact that Daniel has had at such an early stage in his career. His commitment to open science in the service of patients, the transformative tools and resources that his fantastic lab has created and made fully and immediately open, and in the case of the EXACT, a full 2 years before the paper describing them was ultimately published. The impressive science his lab has led with those tools and his unswerving commitment to open access and to service of the patients has made him the ideal winner of this inaugural award, in particular, given this year's tagline of sharing discovery and shaping the future. On behalf of my co-nominators, Jeff Barrett and Mark McCarthy, please join me in welcoming the 2017 Early Career Award winner, Daniel MacArthur.
Thank you very much to Mark for that very kind introduction, and of course to the committee for the honor of receiving this first early career award for the ASHG. So I admit to feeling a little bit embarrassed to being up here on the stage by myself. Science, as was already mentioned earlier in this session, is very much a team activity. In human genetics, I feel it is more of a team activity than almost any other field, and the work that I'll be talking about a little bit today rests very much on many other individuals, and I'll be mentioning some of those people as I go through my journey through science. So I began my scientific career in Australia, as some of you may have surmised from my slightly awkward accent. I studied under Catherine North and did my PhD with her. She was a wonderful PhD supervisor and an ongoing lifelong mentor. In my project with Kathy, I worked on a really interesting genetic variant in the ACTN3 gene, which proved to be a naturally occurring human knockout of the protein alpha-actinin-3. In studying that variant, I learned many lessons from Kathy. Kathy taught me a great deal about science and how to do science in a rigorous and reproducible way. One of the most enduring lessons that she taught me, and that has endures to this day as rule number one of the MacArthur Lab, is that life is too short to work with people that you don't actually enjoy working with. And this has been absolutely critical in building up my collaborative career over the last 18 years. Kathy also encouraged me to seek guidance from many people in deciding where I wanted to go and pursue a postdoc career. And in 2005, at an ASHG meeting in Salt Lake City, I was fortunate enough to bump into this individual, who of course needs no introduction to this audience. After Francis had finished giving a talk, I rushed up to try and grab him. You remember, bear in mind at this point I was a vulnerable young PhD student. I nervously stuck up my hand and asked him very quickly, "Francis, if you were a young PhD student right now thinking about pursuing a postdoc, what area of science would you pursue?" And he rocked back on his heels for a moment, thought about it actually very briefly, and then said very quickly, "I would think about an interesting biological problem that fascinated me, and I would then find a way to apply these newfangled new next generation sequencing technologies to study it more." And so over the course of the next year, I set about finding a postdoc position that would satisfy those goals. I moved to Cambridge in England and worked in the beautiful Hingston Wellcome Trust Genome Campus under the supervision of Chris Tyler-Smith, where I was able to pursue exactly that goal, taking a scientific problem that had interested me for the last 7 years, that is the existence of human knockouts, and pursuing that on the largest set of genome sequencing data that existed at the time, 180 whole human genomes from the pilot phase of the 1,000 Genomes Project. That project went extremely well, and we were able to demonstrate that these variants were in fact extremely common in the human genome and across human genes, and that all of us carry about 100 loss of function variants with around about 20 genes knocked out. So that work went well, and in 2010 I presented it at another ASHG meeting, this time in Washington, D.C. And after my talk I was approached by this wonderful man who just gave that introduction. Mark Daly asked me if I was interested in coming out to interview for a new unit that he was creating at Massachusetts General Hospital and the Broad Institute, and of course I immediately said yes. I went out and interviewed, the interview went well, and I loved the environment, and Mark was extremely persuasive, and so in 2012 I came and joined his unit across these two institutions. Now, the picture that I showed in the previous slide is Mark, as you might find him in Google image searches, looking very serious. This is Mark as we typically see him in his native environment. Here we have him facing a fresh data set, and this is one of my greatest joys as a scientist, is watching Mark chip away at a new data set in front of enthusiastic young trainees, explaining with great animation and hand-waving often exactly why the distributions look the way they do, which bits of the data set are interesting and which bits are likely to be artifacts, and which tests we should currently be running to pursue the next avenue of exploration. Mark is truly one of the most remarkable scientists that I've ever had the good fortune to work with, as well as a kind, a decent, and generous human being, and I've been extremely fortunate to be able to spend the last 5.5 years working in his unit. Mark also introduced me to the Broad Institute and to the many people who work there. At the Broad Institute, I've been able to receive support to do projects at a scale and of a magnitude that would really be almost impossible for any other young faculty member. And I really appreciate the commitment of the leadership at the Broad to the support, both in terms of resources and leadership opportunities for young faculty. So the work that we have done in my lab revolves, as Mark mentioned, around two different distinct areas. We work on applying genomic technologies, that is exome, genome, and RNA sequencing, to understand the genetic basis of Mendelian disease. We have also, as Mark mentioned, worked with a huge number of collaborators, both in the US and around the world, to accumulate very large collections of genome reference sequence data, both exome and genome reference sequence data, that we can then distribute to the rest of the world. And EXAC and NOMAD, as Mark mentioned, have had a tremendous impact on the rest of the world, and it's been extremely gratifying to see the impact both of our rare disease sequencing work on patients and their families, as well as the impact of EXAC and NOMAD on the broader research community. In both of these projects, I've been extraordinarily fortunate to be able to work with a wonderful set of colleagues. I can't name all of them, but I wanted to mention a few specifically by name, particularly Heidi Rehm, my partner in all of the rare disease genomics activities that we currently pursue at the Broad, and as Mark mentioned, the co-director of our Center for Mendelian Genomics. Ben Neal and Sekar Thirasan, who have worked very closely with me on the EXAC and NOMAD projects, as well as many other projects. And David Altshuler, who I was fortunate enough to overlap with for 2 years at the beginning of my research project, and was a wonderful mentor, and also without whom the EXAC project would likely never have started. I'm also fortunate on a day-to-day basis to get to work with this incredible group of young people, a set of individuals as in my lab, who span a wide range of different backgrounds and activities, young scientists, project managers, computational biologists, and software engineers. I can't name all of them. Many of them are here today. I think you guys all know individually that I think you're awesome. But I did want to call out two particular subgroups of my lab, all the trainees who have gone through my lab over the years and who provide me with the energy and enthusiasm that I need to face each day of science and the administrative challenges that that often come up during that process. And secondly, and critically, my senior staff, individuals who help to ensure that my lab runs smoothly, who tell me when things are going wrong, who tell me critically when I am wrong, an important thing that many other people in the lab won't do, and who, without whom, again, the lab would not be functioning at all. And finally, I wanted to thank a really important set of people, my family, my wife Alana, who has followed me across a decade of my career in science and three continents, who has been my confidant, my friend, and my partner in raising three boys, who bring me great joy, but are yet to learn how to pose for photographs. So I wanted to finish with some of the excitement and the challenges that lie ahead for us in human genetics, and particularly three areas where I remain concerned about where the field might go. I think as a community, we have done extraordinary things in accumulating extremely large amounts of genomic sequence data and figuring out how to tie that genotype data to phenotype data. I think we still have a lot to learn about how we can actually engage patients and their family members in the research process and ensure that they are not just, that engagement is not simply a matter of having them sign a 30-page consent form, but making them feel that they're actually part of that research process, that they understand what is being done with their data and why. Secondly, ensuring that our work is meaningfully translated. We have heard, of course, over all of the days of the last week, incredible scientific projects. But we have to go further than that and make sure that our work actually has an impact on the lives of patients. And doing so is not easy. There are many things we have to do to make that possible. One of the things I think is critical is stepping beyond our traditional boundaries as academics and figuring out how to work very actively with the healthcare industry and with healthcare and with the pharmaceutical industry to ensure that we actually have a broad impact. And finally, the human genetics community has, as Mark and others have mentioned, had a tremendous commitment to data sharing that we have seen grow over the last decade. This is incredibly powerful, but it is also fragile, and it's easy to lose our vision for how important data sharing is to the science that we do. It would be a terrible thing to lose data sharing, and I think there are many forces that stand in our way. There is simple apathy, there are the challenges of the existing infrastructure for data sharing here in the US, and there is also fragmentation, the fact that over the next 5 years, an increasing amount of data will be generated not just in the academic setting, but outside the academic setting, in healthcare and in industry. We need to make sure that we can build a framework that makes it as easy as possible for people who get their data generated in those environments can actually share their data meaningfully with research. So I'd like to finish by thanking once again everyone who's been involved in doing the work that led to this award, and once again the committee for the opportunity to come up and receive it. Thank you so much.